Hello and welcome to Charles Sturt University and IT Masters joint course, Server 2012 Configuring and Installation. This is week 4. If you remember, week 1 was run by Stephen. Second week was run by me. I was in Madrid. Third week last week was again by Steve, and now week 4 is with me again. This week we are going to cover configuring print and document services, and we're going to configure the remote management services to the server. We are also going to do a recap for the last 4 weeks. As you all know, there is an exam next week. And if you pass the online exam next week, you will be getting a certificate from IT Masters / CSU, Charles Sturt University basically. So it's going to be not too hard exam. If you listen to me carefully, I will also recap some of the questions that are going to be asked next week. Okay? So please take care. And if you missed the session, probably you can watch it from YouTube as well. So if you have to leave it earlier, it's going to be uploaded in our IT Masters website at YouTube as well. My name is Erdal. I'm a Microsoft Most Valuable Professional, as well as a Microsoft Certified Learning Consultant, Microsoft Certified Trainer, and EC Council Certified Instructor, Ethical Instructor. I'm a Windows Expert, as Microsoft calls us. And I do specialize in security. I speak in worldwide conferences such as TechEd, HackerHalted, Australian Emergency Response Team conferences, etc. If you want more information about me, my blog is here. If you have Facebook or Twitter account, you can just follow me from there. If you have an Android phone or Windows mobile phone or Windows 8 app, you can also download the apps of my blog straight into your phone or blogs. Okay, a bit more information is here. If you need to ask any question regarding this session, all what you have to do is email me. My email address is erdal.ozkaya@itmasters.edu.au, as you can see in the screen. Okay, if you're ready, let's start. This week we are going to cover configuring network printing, then remote access management. First of all, what is printing? I always ask a funny question to all my Oxford students. What do you think a printer is? Of course, when I say what a printer is, most of us think about the hardware, such as HP or Dell or Lexmark or Fuji Xerox hardware devices. But in a Microsoft terminology, printer is a software interface through which a computer communicates with a print device. So, then what is a print device? Okay, a print device is what we call printer in Microsoft terminology. So, when you do an exam, keep in mind, a print device is the printer, that the device that you know as printer. Printer in Microsoft terminology is the software. This is a little tricky question which might get asked in the exams and which might trick you in. So it's very easy to keep in mind. It's just a terminology. As soon as you memorize it, the rest is easy. Okay, what is the print server? If you remember many years ago, we used to not have that big print all-in-one printer. We needed some print servers, which the job was to receive print jobs from clients and send them to a print devices that either attach locally or connected to a network. These days, the big print servers are doing that for us automatically, but you can also have, of course, any Windows server configured as a print server. A print driver is where you share your client's drivers. As you know, the driver is the software of the hardware of the print devices. So, if you're having an XP, Windows Vista, Windows 7, Windows 8 clients, or even Windows 2000 clients, I hope you still don't have any, but if you do, you can share the printers via the software interface, and as soon as your clients need the printer, they can just connect to the share, and Windows will automatically download the printers for you, which they can then start to print their papers. Okay, we have different printing terminologies. I'm pretty sure you all know what a direct printing is, and I'm pretty sure regardless of where you are in the world, you always print at least once into a printer. That's why I'm gonna go a bit fast in here. I'm pretty sure you know what a locally attached print sharing is. Basically, you get a print server, and you attach a computer to a server, or to even a desktop. As soon as you attach it and share it from the local interface via the software, then anybody who is in the same network can print into your printer, print device, in other terms. So, what is the disadvantages here? If this workstation is shut down, then you cannot print anymore. So that's why it is not really the best idea to have printing. A network attached printing is usually, you install the print server role into a server, then they will basically install the drivers into your, into their computers, and as long as this printing pool is active and the printer spooling service is working, then everybody will be able to print directly to the print device, or in other words, printer. That's what we call network attached printing. What is that printer sharing? As I just said 2 seconds ago, printer sharing is there to make our life easier. You can share your printers via the software, via IP, or via the common services. Again, I'm not going to spend too much time on this, because I'm pretty sure most of you have done some printing before in your life, and this is probably one of the easiest topics which you can have. Anyway, printer sharing. There is different options which you can use. One of the newer options, what we call in 2012, is point and print. When you install a printer on a server running Windows 2012, you can also install the driver that other computers can use. Let's say your computer is Windows 2012, the server. And let's say you have Ubuntu, you have XP, you have Windows 7, Windows 8 devices, or even Apple devices. You can install all these drivers for your print server. Your print server will share them for you, may keep it ready for your clients if they need to print anything. They need to drivers, then they can just install the drivers first, and then use the print device. Point and print will enable clients to access the printers installed in a print server. It's important to have the 32-bit or 64-bit drivers ready, as if you are in a hybrid environment in terms of software installation, operating system installation, you should have then the device ready, device drivers ready in both of the operating systems. What is an easy print? Easy print is there to let your remote desktop clients get printing easier. It takes the form of a printer driver that is installed on the server along with the RDP session, the remote desktop session. It will require the remote desktop session host role service. As soon as you do that, your clients are going to install the printing services as well. Printer security. This is an important part, because most of the time we do print confidential data, and you don't want your confidential data to be taken by others, right? You might be printing a credit card statement which has your credit card number inside. You might be printing a CV. You might be printing a CV in your job, I mean in your current job, while you're looking for another job. You don't want your printing your printing be visible for your workmates. So what can you do? Keep in mind, by default, printers assign the allow print permission to everyone they use the printers. So everybody has full access to manage their own documents. When it comes to allow manage documents permission, this can manage any users in documents, like they can pause, resume, restart, cancel the documents, cancel the print queue, and they can even manage the print stuff by others. So That's why you should be careful when you assign manage document permission in a print server. So allow print permission will be enabled by default to everybody. If you have a color printer, you might have two different options. Like you might disable the color printing option to your users. So this can be also given by your print server. But when they have the allow manage document permission, they will be able to jump to any print device they like and manage the queue in the print device. Okay, what else? Allow manage this printer permission is usually to reconfigure the printer. Let's say you are an IT guy who is in a remote site and you don't want to come to configure the printer all the time. What you can do is you can basically get the manage this printer permission, give it to one of the local guys, and they will be able then to manage the printers for you automatically. Print service, it's a server role. What was the server role again? If you remember in week 1, Steve did cover this with you. If you did miss this session up, you can watch it on YouTube. But I'm going to also do a quick recap. I can see a few questions are coming in. I will do quick demo for you what it was. I will show you that very shortly, okay? So what is a print server? Sorry, print service. Once you install the print and document services role, you can use the print manager console to add print service, to view printers, to manage printers and print service. Basically, it's going to give you option to have all this cool stuff for you. I'm just checking my server 2012 installation on the other side. Anyway, okay, what are the benefits of printing? When it comes to benefits of printing, it's recommend, you know, if you use a print server, you will have a centralized management. You will have easier troubleshooting. And instead of giving a desktop printer to all your employees, which will cost much more than a big laser printer, you can just have one big printer in a centralized location, which will keep the total cost of ownership down. Also, you will see who's printing how much, how many pages. This will be also good control for you to keep an eye on your end users. So, there are many benefits of network printing, and we just listed a few of them for you here. Okay, what is an enhanced point and print? Enhanced point and print uses the V4 driver model to provide a simplified management structure for network printer drivers. Okay, what does this mean? It means that print servers do not need to store client print drivers. It means driver files are isolated, preventing the file naming conflicts. It will give you the ability to support multiple devices with a single driver. So basically, you're going to have one driver package to all of your clients. And this driver package are usually much smaller, to keep and much faster to install. The point driver and the printer user interface can be deployed independently, which will give you also the power of controlling what's going on. Security options. We did talk already about two. So, the default security allows everyone to print and manage their own print jobs as I just mentioned a few minutes ago. The available permissions are not just these two. There is also print, manage this printer, and manage documents, as I explained 2 minutes ago. This was a quick recap. I can see questions are coming. Just a quick reminder, we will have the printing, we will have the Q&A session towards our end. Okay, what is a printer pooling? What is a pool? I wish I was in a pool now. Anyway, printer pooling combines a multiple physical parameters into a single logical unit. So think about a real pool. We all go there to have some refreshment, right? Filter pooling is something similar. Basically, it is increasing the ability and scalability of printing jobs. It requires all printers to use the same driver, where you can have full control of the locations of the printers when it's come in terms of scalability. Branch office direct printing. First of all, you might ask me, what is a branch office? If you missed out our previous sessions, let me just open my documentation for you. All right. Let me give you a quick recap of branch caching. All right. This is your branch office. Oops, no, this is not the branch office. Okay, this is your office. Here we go, nice building. Office is your office, okay? And this is the internet. You are now sitting in an internet. You are sitting in a coffee shop. Let's say Starbucks. A coffee shop, okay? You're sitting here and you're in a customer meeting. You want to print some documentation which you need to fax to your customer later. If you have a branch caching, you can cache all this document in your branch office server, or you can print all this documents directly into your office, and when you go to the office, it will be ready for you in your desk. I mean, I assume the print document will not walk to your desk, but let's assume the printer is in your desk, okay? Basically, branch office direct printing will enable client computers to print directly to the network printers that are shared on a print server. Here's what it is, your main office. Is here. I got a better draw here. Your main office is here. Oops. Your main office is here. You are in a client site. What you also can do is, let's say in the client side there's a printer as well. Remember my previous scenario? It will send it to your office, but this time, not in a Starbucks and you are on a remote site, what it can do is, it will know your location and it will redirect the printing into your branch office. And instead of you going to the office and grabbing the documents, you can just walk to the local printer on your visited site. This requires you to have branch office role installed in your Windows 7 or Windows 8 computer. Okay? This requires you also to have Windows 7 or 8 enterprise licensing. If you are not using this, probably then you are not aware of these options as well. How can you deploy printers to clients? You can use group policy. You can use the GPO created by printer management or manually, as usual. Okay. This is it for the printing. Printing is really very easy. I believe everybody knows what group policy is, how group policy works. If not, we have really good courses at IT Masters. Please go and check our website, which is itmasters.edu.au. Okay? If not, go to my blog. I got a couple of more information there. Group policy is basically giving you the power to manage computers one to many. Because I can see here a question was asked about group policy. Today we are not covering any group policy options, okay? I will answer the rest of the question towards the end. Or you know what? I can, there is a good question here by George. Here's the question. It's straight about printers. I have a test Windows 2012 server on which I'm attempting to install printers and scanner. Now it is saying distributed scan server. Perform additional configuration. Hopefully by the end of this webinar, maybe I will know what to do there. As I do not at this time. Okay. Okay, George. This is a new server role by server 1012. Okay. As soon as you install Windows 8 or server 1012, this will, let me show you my print. I'm going to show you my my printers. Yeah. So that's my printers. As you can see, this is my scanner. This is my printer. I mean, the printer is obvious. With scanners, I do have a network scanner, which is not attached at the moment. But as soon as I attach my network scanner to my computer, everybody in the network will be able to scan directly into their computers. Or in other words, if you open the print, and here we go, this is the Windows Factory Scan options. I was just scanning my ethical hacker certificate. Okay, and I can scan this in the printer and send it to my computer directly. All what you have to do is make the role enabled, and as you can see, this is giving us, here's another example. This is my Instructor of the Year award by EC Council. Same with this. What it does basically, as soon as I scan it, it will send it to my, as you can see here, you can just click forward and it will open my email option, and it can, as soon as it's been scanned, it will keep an indication, it will give you the ability to send it to any of your clients. If you have a big office printer such as HP, Canon or Fuji Xerox or whatever, then this option is for you there as well. So basically it is connecting automatically via SMTP to your mail server and giving you ability to send it to your yourself or to anybody in the network or anybody in the contact list. Similar thing here, it will help you to send a fax, send a scan straight from the printer Windows fax and scan options. Okay, all what you have to do is basically install and enable the server role, and to do that you have to just go to add device. This will bring this here. It will scan the network for you. And if it finds your printer, it will basically just gonna give the, it's going to list the options for you here. And that's it. Bada bing bada bong, you're ready to use the printing options. There is one more question about printers. Okay. Is there too many printing questions in the exam? Okay, this is asked by Stephen Cook. Okay, Stephen, to be honest, I am not sure what is going to be in the exam, but I can assure you, whatever we cover here, it's going to be asked in the exam. Okay, for some reason it doesn't find any printers now, but as soon as it finds printers, you will have the options to list your printers here. You can just go to properties. You can then see the hardware. You can check the properties from here. You can share the printer from here. You can see the local queue. You can see the events. You can see whatever happened to your printer. Okay. There is one more question here. Okay. Distributed scan server. So basically, distributed scan server is a server which helps you distribute your scanning options. Any other question about printers? Because I want to cover more important topics. I'm going to unmute all of you towards the end of the session one more time if you want to ask the question and not type. Okay, what is Server Manager for Remote Management? First of all, I better go and show you how Server Manager works. For this, I am opening my demonstration for you. Okay, here's my demonstration. And now I'm going to open my server manager. This is also a review for your stuff that we've done in the last few weeks. So, how is server manager working? Server manager is the place where you manage all your servers which is in your domain or in a workgroup. So all that you have to do is click in the server management icon. This will give you a good overview of all the servers in your network. You can see domain controllers. You can get more information about the event logs of the server. You can run the best practices analyzer. You can check every and each node which is attached to your computers. You can get information about any roles installed, such as DNS. You can get information about the IP addresses. You can see if the server is up and running. You can, for example, create some file and storage services. In this case, what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to create a share. Let's see if there is any share. Oh, yeah. I have already a share. As you can see, I got 40 gigabytes shared and around 35 gigabytes is used. This is equal to 8.5%. Then you can just go and click in task. You can just create new share. From there, you will have the share options. As you can see, this is just a quick recap of server manager for you. So, what else can you do? Just a quick reminder for the exam. This will be covered in the exam. Server 2012 has a beautiful option which I like. If you remember, many years ago, let's say you wanted to install a print server. To install a print server in several computers, you had few options. One of the options was go to each computer and install the print server manually. Second option was run a script. Third option was use the Enter files. Now, you don't have to do this anymore. All what you have to do is go to Manage. Click, I'm going to show you this again. All that you have to do is, here we go. Click into Manage, Create Server Group. From there, you can just scroll down and add the servers that you want to group together. Now, all that you have to do is select the group. As you can see, I'm just creating now different groups. I can just go and call this print service or infrastructure, whatever you like. As soon as you do that, you click OK. Now, you will see a brand new icon here, which is called infrastructure or print service. You can just come to infrastructure. You can get information about infrastructure itself. You can see who is in this group, what kinds of roles and features have been installed in this group. And you can also create a new group. In this case, I'm going to go add some server roles and features. This will run this wizard for me. This wizard is going to help me to create any server role that I like. There is two options for you. First option is going to be role-based or feature-based installation. This is basically a configuration for a single server by adding roles, role services, or features. Or you can add a remote desktop installation. This install requires the role services for VDI, which is the virtual desktop infrastructure, to create a virtual machine-based or session-based deployment. In this case, I go with the default option. You can just create a server pool. Remember, we were talking about a printer pool as well. It's the same idea. You select the pool that you want to create. Then you can just go and install the roles that you like. In this case, print services can be selected, okay? Print and document services. As soon as you create the server role, you can also install some features. So, oh, there is a question. I will answer this question later. So, server role is, let me go back. Firewall is basically giving you the giving a server a new role. You can make a server an active directory, certificate services, a domain services, a federation services. Please go back and watch our previous recorded session. We have some information for you there. Okay. The server feature is basically, for example, .NET 3.5 features, or BitLocker, or client network file services, or IP address management, IPAM. This is a feature which is basically giving some extra features to your server. As soon as you do that, you can just, you will see the role for you automatically there. It will show the print services, and once you click install, it will install the print services role into all your computers. Okay? So you don't have to write a script anymore. You don't have to go through all the servers anymore. You can just make all the servers a print server. I would think twice before I install a print server role into a server. Why? Because print servers usually are servers, they require lots of fragmentation. Why? Because people are printing, so stuff are written to the hard disk, then as soon as print has been deleted, the written delete, and you will have big fragmented hard disk. So it's a good idea to defragment this hard drive most of the time. Windows will do that with Server 2012 automatically, but it's still a good idea to do it manually as well. Alright, this is Server Manager, and this is how you install Server Manager role. Can you do it? There is a question. Can you do it with Server Core? Yes, of course. You can install the Server Core option, and you can do all whatever I showed you via Server Core as well. I think I got a demo for you, which I can show very shortly, okay? Let me go back to my other demo. Alright, any other question about print services? Printers. If you don't want to type again, I will have some towards the end. You will be able to ask me. Okay, let's talk about Server Manager for remote management. Remote management, I think the name is telling us what it does. It's the ability to manage a local server remotely. Let me just... I'm just opening a remote desktop session here, and I'm going to connect to mail server here. Oops, I couldn't connect. Okay, it's connecting to IP address. I'm connecting to a remote site. If the server is up, it's going to be able to let me log in to the server. I'm putting this into other screen until it's logged in. Basically, it's going to give me the option not to walk to the server room, and it's going to give me the option to manage the server. Here we go. In this case, I did connect to Parent Training, Student 25 Desktop. I can just add the password, if I can remember. The password is wrong, it's a Windows 7. What was the password? Anyway, don't worry about the password. But this was just an example how it works. You can also... I hope I can find the remote desktop session, which is live. Today, alright, let's try this one. It's connecting, and now I am connected to Server 2012. So 2008, sorry. Let me just close this down for you. As you can see, this is one of the servers that I manage for my customers, and this is 2008, doesn't matter. Basically, it's giving the option not to walk or not to fly This server is, I believe, in Las Vegas. Yeah, it's one of my customers, and I got the option to basically manage everything straight from here. I can just go to server rules from here, and I can see if it's been set up as a print server. Let's see if it is. Server role, no, I don't see the role. Yeah, here we go. It's a file service, not a print service, sorry. But it has removed desktop services installed, which gives me the ability to manage the server remotely. So that's what remote management is. So, the server manager for remote management gives you the option to add server roles remotely as well. Basically, I can go make a server, AD, DNS, or I can import a text file with an IP address. I can add roles, which is as I am in front of the box. There is only one thing which I can't do remotely, touch the server, or press the shutdown button, or pull the network card out. Okay? So you can do everything what the user interface will allow you. You can configure nick teaming or even restart or shut down the server. And if you have a remote wake-up as well, you can even start the server remotely as well. Keep in mind, WinRM, Windows Remote Management, is enabled by default on server 1012. This is a popular exam question which is asked for you. So what is WinRM? This is an option which will enable you, the administrator, to manage computers from a remote location using tools based on the WMI, which is the Windows Management Instrumentation, sorry, and or PowerShell. You can use the default WinRM settings via graphical user interface or PowerShell to manage your servers. So, what is Server Manager for Remote Management again? You can use also MMC. What is MMC? MMC is the Microsoft Management Console. It's a snap-in which is dependent on the DCOM, which is the Distributed Component Object Model for remote management instead of WinRM. Keep in mind, if you have a firewall, the DCOM settings are not enabled by default. So you have to enable the port in a firewall, and you have to install the .NET framework feature as well as the Windows Management Framework feature from your servers to make it work and running without any issues. Firewall inbound settings, basically make sure the COM network access has been enabled, make sure the NPIN, the RPC and RPC EPNAP has been enabled for you. You can use GUI or PowerShell to enable this options remotely. Give me one thing, please. Sorry, I needed just a sip of water. Okay. Server Manager for Remote Management. Keep in mind, previous version of Windows Server have firewall rules disabled by default. And WinRM needs to be added as well. So, if you have Windows 2008 R2, and you want to support WinRM in 2008 and R2 environment as well, do not forget to install the performance update and Windows Management Framework 2.0 feature. As soon as you install these features, it's time for you to enable the Windows Remote Management by HTTP in rules in your Windows Firewall. All what you have to do is go to your Windows Firewall. I'm trying to firewall settings, Windows Firewall. There we go. Actually, you did not go. Firewall settings. So you have to come here. And you have to enable these roles for you into your Windows Firewall. So this way you can let it work. So basically you're going to select the roles. You can get information, more information via pressing the into details. It came into my other screen here. It was just an example, okay, which you can do easily. You can create a WinRM listener by running the WinRM quick config command in a PowerShell or in the command line, which will give you the admin privileges to enable all the stuff. After you do that, make sure you enable the COM port to access the network access and remote event log management rules as well. After you're doing all this, all what you have to do is create a server group. If you remember, I just showed you how you can create a server group. Then enable the functions, set the criteria, and it's ready for you. Easy. This will basically help you to have server manager for remote management installed automatically. Alright. Can the Windows Server 2012 manager be installed on Windows 7, Windows 8 client machine to manage Windows servers remotely? It can be installed on a Windows 8. And I believe it can be installed on Windows 7 as well, but you have to install the option which I showed you. Okay, I'm just preparing my demo environment. Alright, I will get your question shortly. I can see questions are coming in. Beautiful. I promise I'm going to answer all of them for you. Before I go to my questions part, I would like to demonstrate a few options for you. First of all, okay, someone asked how we can use PowerShell for that. Okay, to use PowerShell, all what you have to do is, hold on, let me just, let me show you the scenario. This is a Windows Server Core PC, okay? What you can do is you can either install the shell commands or you can do the easy way, what I'm gonna do. Once you press Ctrl Delete or Spacebar, you enter the username password. You can just type PowerShell, press Enter. Once you press Enter, what you're going to do is now basically install the graphical user interface for Server Core. To do that, you type Get Windows Future GUI. As soon as you do that, it will give you the options to you have the graphical management tools and infrastructure or server graphical shell. You can just select what you want. Okay, in this case I want to use computer management, and here we go. Now I have computer management in front of me. I can just go to device manager. Hey, I thought this was Server Core. Yes, Server 2012 Server Core is enabling you to have a graphical user interface installed and removed on the spot. You can just come to print management and manage everything straight from here. If you want server management, all what you have to do is excuse me, all what you have to do is type server manager, press enter. From there you can go to tools and you can install your printing services, or you can see if your printing service has been installed, and you can do whatever you want to do straight via the command line. Okay, so there is really no difference. As soon as you do that, you can just add Windows Future Server GUI shell. This will install the graphical user interface for you, but keep in mind this requires restart. Then you have to type restart computer command this. As soon as you restart it, hey, your server core is now a graphical user interface server. You can then just go and, for example, connect to remote management. All right. To show what I done again, I went to run. I just typed Microsoft Terminal Services client. I'm connecting to node 1. I'm just typing my password. I'm clicking OK. And it tells, you know what? This deposit is password. Be aware. OK, no problem. And this will give me the remote management option to serve 1,000 roles. Easy peasy. All right. Let me close my remote shell. There is a question about WinRM. Okay, what is WinRM? WinRM is actually not brand new. WinRM is since Windows Vista available and even Windows 2003 R2. Windows Remote Management, known as WinRM, is a handy new remote management service. It's basically a server component, or the server component, of the remote application and the WinRS, the Windows Remote Shell. So remember, you can do it via shell as well. It will help you to run remote computer, attempting remote manage, basically remote services. Keep in mind, you should have WinRS working before you can go to the second step. Again, I can see I didn't talk about the ports. What are the ports? Okay, the question is, what are the ports? While WinRM usually listens to port 80 by default, which means most of the firewalls have their port 80 open. But keep in mind, it doesn't mean the traffic is unencrypted. Traffic by default is only accepted by WinRM when it's encrypted using the Kerberos SSP. Okay, so it might be port 80, but it's been encrypted. Of course, you can use port 443, which is HTTPS traffic. But there is a default service which will enable you to use the WinRM listener on port 80 or IIS. If you're using WinRM with System Center Virtual Machine Manager, again, Kerberos is there, no problem. As I said, to install it, it's quite easy. All what you have to do is follow the steps, which was install the service, then use the command shell to, you know, to go through. We had this all ready for you in the slide deck. Let me just open it for you. Once you run the quick config, it will help you to have everything automatically. Okay, Windows Remote Management command line tools. Yep, you can use the command line as I just showed you seconds ago. All right, I can see a few more questions coming. What are the differences between WinRM and DCOM? Okay, first of all, what is a DCOM again? DCOM is a distributed component object model. It's a set of Microsoft concept and program interfaces in which client program and object can request services from the server program. Okay, this is a network. DCOM is also, DCOM is there as equivalent for Common Object Request Broker Architecture. It is really not the remote management service, but keep in mind, using DCOM interfaces, you might have the web server program, which can forward RPC calls, the remote procedure calls, but this is not the WinRM, okay? So basically, we cannot compare WinRM to DCOM directly. Any other questions? Let me see. Oops, I closed the mistake. Okay. I think that's all for now. All right. If you don't have any other questions, keep in mind, the exam is next week. So, what is in the exam? Oh, there is a question. Is the exam open book? The exam is online. You're going to be by your own. And you can open the book. But to be honest, you're not going to have enough time to browse for the question in the book and or in Google or Bing. Then answer. It's going to be, you know, you will have enough time to read the question and answer yourself. So, what should you review? Okay, the exam will cover four topics. First of all, you should know how to plan a server installation. You should know what a server core is. I did show you a few already. You should also know how to optimize this resource utilization using feature on demand. You should know how to mitigate role from previous versions of Windows Server. On week 2, I showed you how you can deploy roles on servers, how you can convert server core from the graphical user interface. I showed you that 5 seconds ago. How you can configure services, how you can configure local storage. Last week, Steve showed you what NTFS is, what are the NTFS permissions, what is the volume shadow copies, what are the NTFS quotas. And this week, I showed you the printing architecture and remote desktop services. So all this is for you in our website. If you go to itmasters.edu.au, crucial course, this will tell you what is in the exam. Yes, the exam is also free. And yes, if you pass the exam, you will get a certificate from us, from Charles Sturt University IT Masters. So I would highly recommend you to do the exam. And keep in mind, this course itself will not qualify you for a credit, but this will basically help you to learn what and how we teach. And the final exam basically is free. Okay, let me do some recap about the exam. Okay, what do you want me to show? Do you got any preferences? I think I showed you Server Manager. That's quite easy. I'm just checking. Any question, any preferences that you want me to show about Server 2012? Okay, I want to show some dynamic access control, but this is not in the exam. Alright. Last week, Steven showed you NTFS permissions, okay? The NTFS permissions are by default for you there. As soon as you install Windows, it's there with NTFS. Let me quickly show you. Let me just open Windows Explorer. Okay, I go to my computer. I want to manage my computer. There is my manage computer screen and the other monitor. All right. Now I go to my disk management. You can see that. I'm just checking if there's any questions. Okay, you can see that I got NTFS permissions here, and I got also FAT. Let me open FAT first. I go to properties. That's my camera SD hard drive, not hard drive, SD card. Hey, I don't see any security options in a FAT32 partition. Now, I'm going to my NTFS partition, and look at this. I got security options, so full control, modify. Steven did cover all this for you last week, okay? What else can I show you? This is basically NTFS file and folder permission. It's going to be asked in the exam. Alright, Josh, please, why can't you hear me when I... Alright, sorry, I answered this question already. I have a test. I answered this question as well. Yes, you're right. Robert is asking how much of the exam will be on server core. Promise the exams are going to be hard. It's not going to ask you any server core command lines, okay? As we didn't cover. It's going to cover as we, you know, it's not going to cover more than we showed you. So, please watch the last 4 weeks recording. And all what you have to do is watch it once. Promise you will pass the exam. Hi, Erdal, could you do webinar week 2? Ah, yeah. Stuart Reed is asking the webinar week 2. For some reason, I could not load it. I had a webinar when I was in Madrid 2 weeks ago. I just came back, by the way, yesterday. I was in Turkey as well. It's going to be uploaded today. Promise. It's promised, Stuart. Let me show you one more thing before we go. Storage spaces. Okay, we did cover storages, right? So, what are the storage options in Server 2012? Alright, I go to Server Manager. I go to File and Storage Services. I go to Storage Pools. I go to create a new storage pool. What is a storage pool? A storage pool, you know, will run the widget for you. I click next. You just give a name, which is called pool 1. Now, a storage pool is there to give you, to create a pool from all the storage drawers that you got. What you can do, you can select unused physical disk for the storage pool and choose whatever any disk should be allocated to hot spares or replace failed disk. In this case, I want to select this 3 hard disk. I click next. Now, I'm creating a storage pool location in the server called DC. They're not going to be clustered, but they're going to be all work as one. As you can see, 127 times 3 is 381. As soon as I click create, it's going to say, are you sure? Yes, and this has been created. Beautiful. Now I got my pool. I can go to task. I can create new virtual disk from this pool. So what I did is I did combine these 3 pools, and now this visit is going to help me to create a LUM, which is a logical unit number, which is a collection of one or more physical disks from a previous created storage pool. As you saw, I did create a pool. The length of the data across of the physical disk can increase based on the next option, which I'm going to show you. Are you sure you want to create the storage pool in this? Yeah, of course. What are you going to call it? I'm going to call it virtual disk parity. If you want, you can add the description. Now, it's giving me the option. How would you like to select the storage layout? I can make it simple, mirrored, parity. I go with mirror, which data will be duplicated. Sorry, it wants me to go with parity. Data and parity information are stripped across physical disks. Again, if you watch week 2, which I'm going to upload tonight, because I am uploading at the moment to Dropbox. Or what I can do is I can upload this to a Dropbox as well, where James is going to upload it to YouTube anyway. Okay, James from IT Masters. He's going to upload it tonight or tomorrow morning. But what I can do is if you email me, my email address is here. Okay, please email me and I will give you access to a Dropbox folder. Or you can go to my, if you have Facebook, what I can do is I can basically, where's my thing? I can also add it into my page as well here, okay? You can just download it straight from the Facebook page as well. But it's going to be YouTube for you, guaranteed. Back to my demo. So I create parity. Now I got 2 different options. How would you like to create the provisioning type? I can create tin, which the volume uses the space from the storage pool as needed, up to volume size. Fixed is going to be fixed and it will not grow up after. So you can just specify the size. You can then create and ready. Now it's time to create the LUNs. You can just select the LUN that you want to create, add the size, assign a drive letter, select the NTFS or whatever file permissions. If you want to have data duplication, you can just select it. It will tell you what you have done. As soon as you click create, everything is for you created. Now we have a team provisioning disk of 1 terabyte using a storage pool. We did cover this in the previous weeks as well. This is quite easy to use via Server 2012. Alright. What else did we cover? So I think I did cover everything. I can also show you what we covered in week 2. That's week 4. That's wrong. That's week 2, which what I covered in Madrid. I did cover the server 2012 editions. I did cover what server core is. So for the what is in the exam about server core? Whatever you see here. The exam is going to ask what a function is, what a role is, what a feature is. I know because I think I'm one of the exam question creators. We will cover server manager. We will cover how you can use Server Manager, what you can do with Server Manager. We will also cover how you can join domain online or offline. Okay, here's a tip for you. We will also cover how you can, this is an example of Server Core, how you can configure server via Server Core. We will cover some disk types, what a DAS is, what a NAS is, what a SAN is, what a RAID is. I'm not telling everything is going to be asked. So you're going to have a pool of questions from those. What else? You will also have some questions on, let me just open the, I'm just going to connect to my NAS. So I can do a recap. 2.168.1.77. I don't want you to see my NAS. Hi George, here. No. Okay, if you got any other question, please feel free to ask. 192.168.1.77. Is there any password? I don't know why it's not working. Port 8080. Okay. Hello? I killed my NAS. It's working now. Alright, here's my NAS, my network storage area. This is CSU. So 2012. What did we cover on week 1? Steve covered how to install so 2012, what server virtualization is, what is the installation options, how you can upgrade the server, how you can migrate the server. That's what he covered. And in week 3 again, Steven covered how you configure file and share access, what is SMB, what is NFS, what is file and share access, what is how you can configure file and share accesses, how Windows permission architecture is, how you can allow to or deny permissions by NTFS. He talked also about volume shadow copies, Windows permissions, and this week you know what we covered. That's it. So basically the exam is quite easy. Okay? All what you have to do is watch your recordings. If you go to my blog, I have also some extra videos for you. YourMCT.com. If you come here and type 2012 in terms of server 2012, you can just get some free ebook. Here we go. Okay, here we go, server 2012 resource guide. All what you have to do, all what you have to do is basically you can download server 2012, you can get the URL from here. You can launch videos, you can have a classroom training, don't worry about classroom training. Go to IT Masters, that's the best for you. Don't spend your money and some other big places, at least you will get a university degree from here. There's lots of free videos for you, which will cover server core. Let's click on one of them. It will take you to server 2012. And you can just watch the videos from here. If you want to have a lab access and you don't have a 2012 lab at home, but you want to learn, just go to technet.microsoft.com. So technet.microsoft.com, okay? Here's the website for you, technet.microsoft.com, technet.microsoft.com. Go to learn from there, go to virtual labs. From virtual labs, just go to server, Windows server, and this will give you an option to play with direct access, with HAFL server, with SMB multi-channels, with domain deployment, with network automation, and etc. If you want to learn about file access, grant permissions, you can also play the 2008 version. It's very similar to 2012 when it comes to permissions, okay? So, just press any of these labs, storage spaces. That's what I do most of the time. Launch lab, it will install ActiveX for you and it will launch lab for you automatically. Alright, I'm just going to check if there is any other questions, by the way. Hi Erdal, could you do webinar V2? Oh yeah, I answered this question already. Alright, I can see people started to leave. Only one person. Okay. So you can get the manuals from here, you can start the VLAB from here, you can get information from here, and it will take up to 2 minutes to install as I showed in week 2. Alright, that's it for now. What I'm going to do is I'm going to unmute all of you. Alright? I'm unmuting all of you. If you have any question, feel free to talk to me.
Thank you.
Alright, I can hear some of you already. Woody, Chester, Craig, you're all unmuted. Ivan, George, you're unmuted. Ivan, I can't unmute you. I think you're calling us at the moment on your phone. Thank you, James. I received already feedback. Oh, no. That's why we don't do unmuting. Because that's what happened at the end. I'm just unmuting close to 40 people, so I'm sorry. It's taking some time. Alright, if you got questions, time for you to talk.
Hello, this is Peter. I have a question.
Go for it.
Hi, I was just wondering if the PowerPoint slides could be shared from week 1 through to week 4.
I think the answer is yes. What I can do, I make sure that we put it in our website, in IT Masters, okay? If not, I will put them also into our blog, into my blog, okay? By the way, this is the virtual environment for you. is disconnecting at the moment. Any other questions, please feel free to ask.
Just one on the example, but Erdal, is it a certain number of questions? Is it a fixed number of questions, or is it adaptive, or?
It's going to be mixed, to be honest. I still didn't create the questions. Okay? But what I'm going to do is I'm going to create mixed questions. Basically, a little bit multi-choice. This might promise, if you listen to all four webinars, you will pass it. I mean, there is really, it's not going to be too easy, okay? I don't want everybody to feel like, oh, why did I spend my time here? It's going to be reasonable. Just to let you know, I work with Microsoft Learning as well in terms of writing real exam questions, okay? So I do write real exam questions for Microsoft Learning as well. So I'm going to use those skills to have some reasonable exam for you. Another question?
Yes, how long the exam will be?
I think it's going to be, to be honest, I had all the answers for you. Hold on, give me 1 second, I'm just going to check my email. James, are you there? Do you know the answer for that?
Hi, Erdal, I think yes. I can see this.
Please, James, please help me because I didn't know my
The exam will be 40 questions.
40, beautiful.
And how long? How long?
We usually do them at about 1 hour, but we'll be running through them ourselves just to make sure that's enough time for everyone or most people, and basically make it.
So let me tell you how we do it at Microsoft Learning. Depending. With Microsoft Learning, we create, you know, as James said, we write the questions. Okay, it goes through the psychometrician, I call it, okay, psychometrician, and they, you know, people do some test exams, and based on how much people spend time, Microsoft puts the time. Well, I think we're going to do something similar, right, James?
Yeah, it'll almost certainly be an hour, but possibly a bit longer. I think we've previously done an hour, and that's worked out quite well for 40 questions.
I think that's more than enough. James, I just promised Stuart that I'm going to upload the stuff to Dropbox, okay? Because he was asking me.
What was that, sir?
One of the attendees, Stuart, is just asking about week 2 recording, which was keep failing for me. So I'm going to send it to you shortly. Please upload it, otherwise he's going to shoot me. Are you there, Stuart?
Yeah,
I can hear his voice. All right, any other question, guys? All right, quickly, I'm just going to show you a few more stuff, okay? I don't want to go. It's not really, I should go, otherwise the recording is going to be too long. All what you have to do is, you know, come to manage in this case, add server roles, click next. Next, in this case, I'm going to call it print server role, okay? I can just select a virtual address, come on, at which role, you can do it with role, okay? Just remember I showed you that in my demo environment, just follow the steps, install whatever you like, and it is giving you 2 hours to, as you can see it. Let me just, it's going to give you 2 hours to do the, to complete the lab, play as you wish, and once you're bored, you can just click end lab button here, and it will basically kill the lab for you. Alright, it looks like nobody else has a question. Alright, thanks for making my life easy. I can go and enjoy myself. Any other question? Alright, I'm stopping recording now. For the ones they couldn't join us live, please make sure you go to itmasters.edu.au for more free courses. I think we have a great one coming soon. Guys, if you're interested in security, I just joined myself. Okay, go for it.
So we can get the session from itmaster.com.au, right?
Yes, yes. Don't get me wrong, are you from Germany?
No, I'm Australian.
Australian, you got German accent. I was going to speak German to you. All right. Look, this is the new upcoming short courses, the July one, the CIS security one. It's great. Come and register yourself to this course. If you're interested in security, you will have a beautiful 6-week long course here, okay?
Okay.
If you want to learn hacking, I do have a beautiful session starting next week at Charles Stewart at the Masters again. Make sure you call our university and we have a great hacking course starting next week. Or the next 15 weeks, I think. So, if you want the only 3 months, everything is listed for you here, Photoshop in the classroom. Guess what? I'm gonna be joining this one as well. So feel free to join all our courses here. They're all for free. Of course, I don't mind if you join my real classes as well. Do I got any of my students in this class this week who attended my session at CSU? No? All right. That's it, basically. I forgot to stop the recording. I'm stopping the recording. Thank you very much for watching the recording. And we're looking forward to seeing you in our next webinar again.